You've done some investigative reporting research on there has been expansion of drug cartels coming into California. Can you tell us what's happening right now in California in the desert area where the drug cartels are coming in?
Yeah, so essentially what's happening right now is Prop 64, when it passed in 2016 in California, it legalized cannabis statewide. But the huge issue with this prop that it made it legal cultivation, which used to be a felony in our state, and it downgraded to a misdemeanor. So when this passed in 2016, it was a proposition that had good intentions because it was meant to get black and brown people out of jail and not throwing people into jail for pot. But since it did make illegal cultivation from a felony to a misdemeanor, it essentially opened the floodgates to these drug cartels and this kind of black market that we're seeing with marijuana. And this problem actually started up in North California, so made its way from Humboldt County, and it's trickled down now to Southern California. So there's an area in Southern California, like North LA County, it's called the Antelope Valley, has communities like Palmdale, Acton, Eastside Lancaster, Lake Hughes, and even the county next door. But we went to North LA County after we found out some information through Congressman Mike Garcia. I met him when I was reporting at the border, because that's been our main issue, is the border crisis. And Mike Garcia mentioned to me that the reason that he's focused on the border as a congressman from California is because these drug cartels are coming in, human smuggling, and illegal marijuana. And I kind of was a little bit shocked really to hear that, because I grew up in Palmdale. It's a really like desert community. People like to get out there because they don't want to live in the city. So very family friendly community. It's always been safe. And so when I made my way down there, and just my eyes were just, I couldn't believe what we were seeing. We were seeing illegal marijuana operations all over the desert. According to LA County sheriffs, they're saying there's over 500 illegal marijuana operations. So the big issue with this is, when people here in California, when they think illegal marijuana, they shrug their shoulders. They say, hey, it's not a big deal, it's just pot. And there's kind of a misconception that they think it's like just kind of hippie dudes in the middle of nowhere growing their plants, listening to Bob Marley. And they have no idea there's a whole criminal element. So what we found out was that these Mexican cartels, Chinese mafia, and the Armenian crime organizations are moving to these desert areas, are taking them over, as in buying properties up, or what they call squatting, where they just set up their illegal marijuana operation just on the wide open land. So what they'll do is they'll set up an illegal marijuana operation, they'll get the infrastructure, so they'll get white tarps, hoop houses, and set up these illegal marijuana grows. And what they do is they actually smuggle migrants from the southern border and force them to work these grows. So what we're seeing is labor trafficking in real time. They actually arm these migrants with weapons because they're actually battling other cartels in the desert. So now we're seeing gunfire fights, we're seeing the homicide rate. These cartels have shot at the police multiple times. You're gonna see that in the documentary when we interviewed San Bernardino County Sheriff Shannon Dykes. So we found a human smuggling trafficking problem connected to this. As you guys all know, marijuana needs water to grow. And since these are illegal marijuana operations, they're not getting the water legally. So a couple ways that they're stealing water from us is they tap into the California aqueduct, they'll drill their own illegal well, or they'll tap into the wells of other residents. So we're seeing water theft at record numbers right now. So every day that these illegal marijuana operations are operated, between 3 million to 9.6 million water gallons are being wasted. And for those who live in California, know that water is everything to us as we go through this drought. So human smuggling problem, water problem. We're seeing an environmental problem, because what these cartels are doing is they're spraying chemicals and pesticides on the outdoor marijuana, so like that these animals out there in the deserts don't eat the plants up. The huge issue with this is that these chemicals and pesticides reap into the soil and actually are making their way into the riverbed and into our water now. So now we're seeing an environmental problem. And the worst part of this is the violence now. Now the violence has gone up, the homicide rate's gone up. Out there in LA County sheriffs, they'll find bodies that have been shot and killed connected to these illegal marijuana grows. Last year, the LA Times reported that there was a 26-year-old man from Guatemala who was forced to work these grows. He ended up escaping and was shot and killed. They shoot at the American citizens, they shoot at the police. So it's something that needs to be taken very seriously, and these cartels are just operating in the wide open, something that we've really never seen before. So in LA County, the sheriffs have identified over 500 illegal marijuana operations. The county next door, San Bernardino, has over 1,000 illegal marijuana grows. So just between two counties that are next door, we're almost at 2,000, and that number continues to climb every single day, because it's almost like the police are playing whack-a-mole. I mean, they raid two or three or four a day, there'll be another 10 popping up that same day.
So can you tell me how this is possible with all the you know, policing that we have, and knowing that there's 500 people operating and 1,000 people operating, how is this possible? How are these cartels coming in and doing that?
So the reason why this is possible is because LA County doesn't have enough resources, a sheriff department, to raid these girls. So for instance, if you're out there in the desert, like in Nenac or Western Antelope Valley, and you run into these folks or you see water theft, you call the local sheriff, they either don't come out or they literally tell you that, hey, we can't come out because it's gonna take an hour and a half, 2 hours to get there. So for these sheriffs, they can't even come out because it takes a whole operation unit. So in July, LA County Sheriff, they did their largest, you know, marijuana bust out there in the Antelope Valley where we spent time. It was a 10-day operation. And for LA County Sheriffs to do that, they had to contact the DEA, the DOJ. They had to go in there with Riverside County Sheriffs. They had to go in with Ventura County Sheriffs. So it can't be a single county problem. So it's a multiple unit situation. So even that 10-day raid, even though they were able to bust up to over $1 billion worth of product, that 10-day operation cost the department $1 million. The 2020 defund the police movement also hurt law enforcement fighting these efforts. And so when you're out there in the desert, there's no law enforcement. So these guys basically found out that, hey, we could operate here in the wide open. There's no police. So that's another big thing. We're seeing that, like I said, Prop 64 is what opened it up, because now, let's say that they bust an illegal marijuana grow that has either 50 or 50,000 plants, they're just gonna get hit with a misdemeanor, a $500 ticket. So when I talk to LA County sheriffs, when they raid these grows, they want to find the human smuggling, they want to find weapons on undocumented migrants, because like that, they could attach a felony charge when they bring it to the DA. But here in LA County, we have District Attorney George Cascone, who is very progressive, soft on crime, and they don't think this is a big deal. The LA County Board of Supervisors, there's four liberals versus one Republican, which is Catherine Barger. So she's trying to raise the alarm on this issue, but you have four county supervisors that don't think this is a big problem. And the reason is because, like I said, it's a huge misconception right now that it's just pot. It's not, you know, there's no criminal enterprise connected to this. And what we're finding out too is through the real estate market.
So how does that work? So these cartels, they're coming in and buying land and they're growing these, they're putting these operations on these lands?
Yeah, so kind of an example that we found out is when we were reporting in Acton. So Acton is this kind of community between Valencia and the Antelope Valley. So right there in the middle is Acton. And in Acton, 90% of their illegal marijuana grows are controlled by the Armenian crime organizations. What these Armenians are doing is that they're buying homes and they're buying them through pre-approval loans, and they attach them to an LLC with that business tracing back to Glendale. And what they do is the Armenians, for example, they like to actually buy a home and they'll gut the whole inside of the home and do indoor grows. We're seeing that the Mexican drug cartels and the Chinese mafia, they are actually more comfortable doing the outdoor grows. You'll see that they have kind of a larger scale operation. The Armenians, like I said, they buy homes, they do indoor grows, or through just squatting, meaning that like out there in the desert, they'll just set up on land that's not theirs and they'll just set it up. But when we speak to the residents, they've been approached by these cartel members. So one thing that's pretty common in the real estate is, let's say there's a home going for $150 on the market, they'll pay $220, $230, way above asking value, and make sure that property is theirs. The thing is because the violence and the water theft is so high in these areas, these residents are just giving up and selling their homes. And they're selling these homes, unfortunately, to these cartel criminal organizations that are tied to this. So it's through real estate, it's through violence, and it's happening at a level that we've never seen before. I mean, we were out there reporting and we were running into neighborhoods that were all cartel controlled. There was, you're gonna see in a documentary, we interviewed one man named John, where he's literally the last kind of working class man living in his neighborhood, because all the homes
all the
around
surrounding
him
areas
have already been bought. And a big red flag when you're approached by these guys. So let's say I wanted to buy a home from you. I would come in and say, hey, how many bedrooms do you have? Is there a school nearby? The common questions you ask when you buy a home. These guys, when they buy a home, they just want to know, where's the access to the water and where's the next major highway? So those are kind of the red flags you see. They're always willing to pay above asking price.
And these are areas where there are dirt roads and people can't see what's going on, right?
Exactly.
You could say it's in the middle of nowhere where nobody mm-hmm. can see you, what you're doing, right?
Yeah, it's very Wild Wild West. You know, it's almost like the old cowboy movies out there in the desert, middle of nowhere.
What about these residents that live in these areas? Are they afraid of what's happening to their communities?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely terrified. The majority of residents that we interviewed in documentary have either already or are going to put their house up for sale, because for these residents, these are folks that go out to the desert to retire. They put all their kind of money into the home. And because the water theft is so high and the violence, they don't want to deal with it anymore. It gets to a point where out there in the desert, we were interviewing people that actually have no go zones out in the desert for the first time.